Hello my fellow creative spirits. So today I am going to do the second part of the tutorial for how to glaze AI. So for context, if you want to watch the first part of this video, it'll help you out with figuring out how to do the opaque underpainting that is monochromatic. And in this one, I'm going to go into how I get those colors onto that monochromatic painting and add that richness and depth that glazing does. So before I go into that, I kind of want to talk about what materials I'm going to be using. It's pretty much the same materials as last time, but instead of using Galkid, I am just going to use linseed oil, and that's it. Because of the fat over lean rule, I want to use the fattier substances, or in this case linseed oil, to put on top of the thinner layers that I made in the opaque underpainting. So for what glazing actually is, glazing is when you take thin, transparent, oily layers on top of a monochromatic or even a colored painting to add richness and depth and color. This allows you to get effects that you can't get with just going on right away with alla prima. And I found that this is extremely helpful also in being able to color correct, because sometimes you don't get the colors right in the first go. So this helps you kind of go in and continue to build on that color and fix things and look at the colors and make sure that you're getting the right tone and value. So all of this, when I start the glazing, the painting has to be 100% dry, all of the underpainting, because you do not want to smear around what you worked on before. You're just going to build on top of that. So here what I'm just doing is I'm taking the three primary colors, red, yellow, and blue, and kind of very thinly applying it and mixing it with the linseed oil so that it's just ever so light color. And I also take my napkin here and there and kind of blot it away if I feel like I get a little bit too much on there. And just continuing to go in and build up upon that color. You want it to make sure that it's extremely thin, because that's the most important part about this, is that it's going to take multiple layers. That initial layer might be very intense looking. It's not going to be the correct color, and that's okay, because you're going to continue to add colors on top of that and continue to add more layers, and that will really bring in the richness of the colors and also soften up the colors a bit. So a big tip is you want to be patient to do this technique, because the layers will take a while to build up. But if you're painting very thinly with the linseed oil, you won't have to wait too long. Like, it could be touch dry by tomorrow after you do your first layer, because of the thinness of the paint, it will be ready to paint over the next day. So each consecutive layer that you're going to be doing, you want it to dry completely before you go into the next layer and the next layer. So as far as the actual colors that I'm going to be using, you could technically use pre-mixed paint of a certain color and then thin it out. Or you could use the primary colors, as I'm doing here, to add to the linseed oil and apply it to the painting. As far as the actual paints that you're using, you can technically use any paint that you want. On the tube, it will tell you if it's an opaque or a transparent paint, and it's completely fine to use either one. Just know that with the opaque paints, you're going to have to thin them out a bit more with the linseed oil than you would with the transparent ones. But either of the two work completely fine, and I have not had any problems with these. A tip that I also give with painting and doing glazes, you want to really look and observe the colors in your reference picture, because a lot of what we think we know isn't what we actually see. So when we see the skin colors, while we might think that it's that flesh tone or whatever skin tone that it may be, we kind of had like these preconceived notions about what skin colors are, and they aren't really what we think they are. So you just want to look into it. You'll notice that there's greens and blues and purples under the skin that we might not think that are there, but they are. So you just want to take that into consideration and also add those into your mix of colors that you're adding into the skin tone specifically. And pretty much anything in life, you might think that something is a certain color, but when you really observe it, there's actually light reflections that are emitting maybe like a blue hue. Like in here, while there's like the white parts in the inner corner, I did add a tiny bit of blue because of the outdoor light. It was reflecting a blue off of those highly reflective surfaces. And also the whites of the eyes, I also added some blue because it wasn't a complete white, or in here the burnt umber white mix that I had. Another question that I got about glazing was what to do if I get the glaze into the white areas. So this is very common. I might accidentally glaze the whitest whites and I did not want to do that. Or I might get a color that's a little off and I'm trying to take it off with my napkin and it doesn't come off. That's completely fine, because at the end of it, what you can do is that you can go in with white paint again and fix it and color correct it. So adding that white on top of it will make that white stick out even more. So every once in a while, if you need to come in and like add the whiter whites because you kind of accidentally painted over it with glazes, you're completely fine to do that, as long as the white is a fatty white. So you want to make sure that it's mixed with linseed oil so that it doesn't cause any cracks or anything like that. But I have not had any problems with doing that and adding white over top of the glazes. And you can also blend the white by putting in the white while the glaze is still kind of wet, and you can kind of blend it that way as well. The nice thing about glazing too is that you can come in and darken some areas that maybe you didn't get the tones completely right on when you did the underpainting. So what I like to do is I like to mix red, blue, and yellow together and add them to the darkest areas. For example, the innermost pupil, I added that red, blue, brown mix pretty much and just deepened it that way. Again, as you see here, as I'm adding the new layers, the colors become a little less intense and they become more softer and better. The colors are more true to the reference picture. And this, like I said with the last tutorial, it's something that if you work a lot on something, eventually you'll get it right. You just have to keep working at it and working at it. And the longer you spend on it, the better the outcome will be and the more you will learn about the process as well. And that pretty much concludes this tutorial. I hope that you guys learned a little something from my technique. This is not completely my technique. This is adapted from Vermeer's technique, which I've seen lots of other artists do as well. I hope that you guys give it a try because it's a lot of fun. You know, everyone's technique is different. You take this with a grain of salt. There's different ways of doing glazes. This is just the way that I found to be the easiest to understand. It's not as hard as you might think it is. It sounds really fancy, you know, but it can add a lot of depth and richness to your work. And you can do this on top of already colored paintings as well and add like the rosy cheeks or something like that. So if you guys have any questions whatsoever, please feel free to leave it in the comments. I'll try to get back to them as soon as possible. And also, if you don't already, make sure that you follow my Instagram and my Facebook page and all of that. The links will be in the description. And don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. If you like content like this, I'd love to hear what other tutorials you guys would be interested in. And besides that, I will talk to you guys next time. Bye!